Thanks for tuning in to Stay Sharp with Razorleaf, your secret weapon for all things digital and products in manufacturing. In this episode, we welcome Maria Morris from SharePLM to the podcast to discuss the critical role of organizational change management, also known as OCM, in digital transformation projects. Jonathan, Jen, and Maria explore how OCM goes beyond mere training, focusing on the importance of clear communication, stakeholder engagement, and creating a strong narrative to minimize resistance and ensure successful adoption of new technologies and processes. This conversation highlights the need for continuous learning and the significance of aligning all stakeholders to a common vision to drive project success. Let's listen in.
Hello, and welcome to Stay Sharp, the podcast about all things digital related to products and manufacturing. And if you're used to hearing my co-host Jen kick things off, oh, we're changing things up a little bit. Well, at least for today. But Jen's still here, right? So I'm Jonathan Scott from Razorleaf, one of your co-hosts. And I've got with me my other co-host, Jen Ferrello.
Hey there.
And today we have a special guest. So welcome to our special guest, Maria Morris of SharePLM. Maria manages business development activities for SharePLM, but she's been a change management consultant in the past. And SharePLM is an independent consulting firm focused on the people aspect of digital transformations. So, you know, in a nutshell, SharePLM and Maria are experts in the topic we want to talk about today, successfully adopting new technology and processes. So welcome, Maria, and thanks for being here.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
Well, so we have, Jonathan, you and I have talked about OCM, or organizational change management, quite a few times already. We love to dig into the people side of technology because it's the harder side. But I wanted to, you know, with Maria here and her expertise, I really wanted to, like you said, we wanted to dig in a little bit deeper. So let's set the stage for the conversation today, because what we really want to dig in to the why and the how of this particular topic. So to get into that, though, let's set the table by talking about what you do, Maria, as a change management consultant at SharePLM.
Yes, definitely. So as you were mentioning, organizational change management, or OCM, as we more commonly call it, is all about helping people adapt to changes within an organization. So it doesn't really matter whether it's a new technology, new processes, or new structures within an organization. It's about helping employees understand the change first, the reasons behind it, getting them to accept it, and then making them feel comfortable enough to get on board with it. So essentially, that's what my job is, and what we focus on at SharePLM is it's really helping organizations to minimize the resistance that they face when implementing a new change, and building that buy-in from all of the key stakeholders.
So it's interesting. We get a lot. It's OCM. That's training, right? It's training us how to use the products. Sounds like it's a lot more than that. So
definitely, yes. And this is something I know we've all spoken about before, that OCM has kind of become synonymous with system-based training. And when you have these projects within organizations, and when we enter projects, when organizations are implementing a new system, for example, they say, oh, you know, we've got the change management side sorted. You know, we've got some training activities happening at the end once the system has been implemented. And we kind of have to take a step back and say, but wait, a few system-based training activities doesn't equate to a full OCM strategy. So I think that's really important to begin with first.
Yeah, exactly, right? We hear that plenty ourselves in these projects, that like, well, yep, I've got training planned at the end and we have a help desk, and so we'll support people and maybe we'll focus for a couple of days right at go live and have some people around to help, right? But, and that's it. Like, that's the plan. You're like, hold on.
Sounds like putting the cart before the horse. But if it's not just training then, where does OCM start?
So OCM essentially starts right from the beginning. So when a change project comes to fruition, when we first decide, okay, we have this business requirement, we need to implement a new system. Before the system has, you know, even been implemented, we need to start engaging the key stakeholders. So these are the people who are going to be affected by the change, whether it's directly, whether it's indirectly. We need to really start getting them on board right from the beginning. And the way that we do this within our projects is we always begin by saying you need to develop a very clear and concise vision and narrative surrounding the digital transformation. And the reason why I say it needs to be clear and concise is because this is a message that is going to travel throughout the beginning to the end of the project. And it's what people are going to refer back to when they are wondering, what is the why behind this change? Why are we implementing this new system? What is the purpose behind it? How is it going to affect me personally? So by having this clear narrative surrounding the change from the start, you can better help people not only get on board with it, but also take control of kind of the talk and the narrative behind the change before you give other people the opportunity to, you know, fill the gaps themselves and allow for the spread of misinformation, for instance.
I'd like to draw an analogy to one of the things we talk a lot about at Razorleaf is core values. And establishing those as a company allows people to refer to them when they're wondering what to do. How should I behave? And you can refer back to those core values. And they do need to be, to your point, clear and concise, because you don't want long-winded things that people really have to think. This is what you do. This is what we're doing, and this is why we're doing it. So that when there's some question about, okay, what do I do next? You refer back to those and like, oh, okay, this gives me the direction that I need then.
Listening to you both talk about this, this is what I want to insert on this, is it makes me think of exactly one word, alignment, right? It's everybody knowing, well, where are we going, right? That, like you said, direction, alignment, same concept. Like, is everybody on the same page about what we're doing? And Maria, you mentioned something, I think, which is really important, can be subtle, but it's about how far and wide that message needs to travel over time, across people. But really, if you want an organization aligned to something, you've got to make sure they know what they're aligning to. And it has to be concise. Like you said, Jen, it's got to be clear. It's not like, oh, it's some wandering thought that somebody had one day. It's, nope, this is what we're doing. That's how we get places, right?
Exactly. No, it's so true, Jonathan. And I think another thing as well that is important to touch on here is that the narrative that you build around the change, it does need to be slightly adapted based on the stakeholders in which you're approaching about the change. Because, you know, if you're approaching, for example, you know, the executive level, the managers, and you're trying to get them on board, what is going to motivate them to get on board and behind the change is going to be very different to what's going to get the end users motivated to get behind the change. So I think that's also a very important point to note, is that you really do need to, in any other way in which, for example, if you had a marketing strategy and you're trying to market a new product and you have to segment your audience based on their needs, based on their requirements, based on their personal feelings and situations, you have to do the same when it comes to an OCM narrative in order to get the people on board, and so that they can actually see themselves in the change before it even happens.
Right, so different audience, different message, mm-hmm. you know, or maybe same theme, different message, but you've got to know who
exactly.
you're speaking to, is your point.
Exactly. So just subtle differences, but they definitely make a big difference.
When you brought up an interesting point too, I think all of this is fascinating because so often it doesn't get discussed in the technology part of the project, technology discussion, right? We're over talking about, you know, APIs and transport protocols. I mean, all kinds of crazy stuff, but we're not talking about motivation, right? That one of your points, right, is you got to think about who you're talking with and what motivates them. What's going to make them want to hear the message, listen to the message, consume it, align to it, all those things. And you have to think about those. It's like we've talked about on this podcast before, Jen, right? The people piece is tricky, but you're even highlighting all of the things you need to think about as you're working this people side of the issue.
Yeah, no, exactly. That's a really good point. And as you said, the message does need to be subtly changed and modified based on the audiences. For example, if we are talking to executives, for example, who have just invested in this new system, for example, and they spent a lot of money on it, they're going to be more interested in the financial side of the investment, making sure that they're getting their return on investment, making sure that they can avoid, you know, potentially having wasted all this money and nobody using it. Whereas when you talk to end users, and this is why we always say we put people at the center of change. And when we refer to people, a lot of the times it is the end users, because ultimately they're the ones who are using the system. Because as we've mentioned many times before in conversations, it doesn't matter how amazing a system is. It doesn't matter how well the technical teams have adapted the system to make sure it has all the functions and capabilities to meet the business requirements and the business processes. If the users don't use it, it's been for nothing. So the nuances almost in the way in which you approach the change with these different stakeholders is very important.
So what types of information do you need to communicate? How often? And really, why? Why can't you just put it out there and be like, hey, this is what we're doing. Get on board.
That's a very good point. I mean, I always kind of bring it back to our personal lives. You know, when people kind of spring something on you, they spring an important announcement or something that you weren't expecting onto you that's going to completely change the way in which your day-to-day activities take place. That's going to come with a bit of shock and immediate resistance. So the reason why communication is so important, and we always, you know, emphasize this in our projects, is because by setting clear communication channels and making sure you're communicating to the right stakeholders, communicating the message behind the change, communicating what they can expect and when their activities are going to, you know, start changing to be using the new systems and processes, etc., it allows them to slowly get on board with it. They don't feel like something's just been thrown in their face. They feel like, okay, well, I've been hearing about this for a while now. They've already explained to me what the purpose of this is. I already understand the vision. And now, you know, I feel that I've been included from the beginning of this process. And I don't feel so much like an outsider. I feel like I'm part of this change.
And I think that's key, right? Because if you feel part of something, if you feel listen to and that you are contributing value, then you own a bit of it. And if it's your solution as well, then you're a whole lot more committed to it than if it was something somebody was handed down from on high, basically. The thing that also struck me is that not just are you communicating, but you're communicating often. Mm-hmm. Different messages, but consistently reinforcing and building as you go through it. It's not just this is what we're doing, and this is why, and here's how it's going to go. It's, and here are the next steps, and this is the value that we're realizing, and, you know, this is what it looks like now, and et cetera.
Yeah, and that's such a great point. You know, communication is not a one-off announcement every now and then saying, here is a huge change that's coming now. And then in a couple of months' time, you announce another great change that's coming as part of this process. Communication needs to be, you know, done on a regular basis, but with also different kind of motivations and objectives as well. So while a big side of communication is, you know, expressing what is happening and when it's going to be happening, but it's also giving, you know, all of the stakeholders a place in which they can also voice their own feelings, opinions, concerns, mm-hmm. hesitations, points of potential resistance to the change as well. So communication shouldn't just be a one-way stream. It should go both ways.
I think that's an interesting point, especially as it relates to something you mentioned earlier about people being resistant when they hear like, whoa, I'm surprised by that. Hold on. You know, immediately there's I'm not sure how I feel about this. And that two-way communication is essential if you want to know why that is. Why are they not sure about it? What are they concerned about? And those are the things that, and I think people see this in technology projects when they get to the backside, those are the things that slow them down, interrupt the project, stop it sometimes, right? Is you want to know those things so you can deal with them instead of finding them out when they really are going to get in your way.
Exactly. And that's such a great point, Jonathan, because as you said, when you do open those communication channels very early on in the process and you do speak to the end users, you do speak to the key stakeholders, and you anticipate what their points of resistance are going to be, you can then adapt your strategy based on those points that are raised within these kind of communication forums. And from that, you can then develop your kind of approach to the change in a more kind of proactive as opposed to reactive strategy.
Right, because I imagine the The longer you let, like so many things, right? The longer you let it go, fester, what have you, like the more dug in people are in their positions.
Yeah. And it also translates to something else that, Maria, you just said about frequency of communication, right? So you get people kind of fired up about something and then you don't talk about it for a while. Well, guess what? Mm-hmm. Then you get the rumor mill going. Oh, yeah. You know why they're doing that? They're going to reorganize the such and so department, you know, because that system's going to do this and we don't need the, you know, it gets this craziness going. And it's like, what is it? Nature always fills a vacuum, right?
Exactly. It's so true.
And people really do have that tendency, like in the absence of information, they tell themselves stories.
Mm, exactly. Yeah. You have that Chinese whispers effect. When you don't have all of the information, you kind of make it up yourself to try and create that story and fill those gaps. That's a really good point. So it's all just about making sure that you maintain the control behind what messages are being sent out regarding the change. And then as soon as you hear points of resistance coming up, then, you know, going back to the drawing room and looking at ways in which you can actively and proactively kind of overcome these potential challenges.
So other than like communication, which is a big piece of overcoming that resistance to change, mm-hmm. and the resistance to change is a big piece of OCM, basically, is, you know, and making things successful. What are some other aspects?
Yes, of course. So, I mean, learning, as we mentioned, so training is obviously something that has become, you know, most thought of when we think of OCM. But when we think of training, that's normally is the type of training we find within digital transformation projects, is it's very often system-based training. And by system-based training, what we mean is, and I know you've talked about this in previous podcasts, but system-based training, you know, essentially it's the clicks in the system. It's if you click here, this will happen. If you click here, that will happen. When in reality, when we approach training from an OCM point of view, we look more at a role-based approach. So this is actually tailoring training to the specific use cases, the specific needs of the different end users who are actually going to be using the system. So essentially, it's not just showing them what to do within the system, but also telling them why they're doing it. So how does this fit in with the wider picture? How does this fit in with the processes I need to follow?
I love this topic. I love it. It's because I, you know, from my experience in consulting, right, before I really understood a lot of the picture of OCM and the pieces that you've been talking about, Maria, it was sort of just a lesson learned, right? Is we would do training years and years ago, and it was the click kind of training. When you click this, that happens, you know, and what you'd get, all the questions in class and the feedback you'd get at the end of a class survey and things like that were always like, well, that was great. And the instructor really seemed to know what he was talking about, but I didn't quite follow what I'm supposed to do with it. Or I got back to my desk and I wasn't sure how to apply it. Or those are the things, right? Those are the gaps that lead us to understand that, no, if you really want people to adopt it, you've got to answer their questions, not after the fact, answer it in the training that you give, right? And what's the question they want to know? What do you want me to do tomorrow? The change happened. What is it you want me to do, right? And it's not click this and get a result. It's here's the new process. Here's how you do the existing process with the new tool. Here's the new process and tool together, and I want you to use it in this way to accomplish this thing. Like that's the point that you're getting at, right?
Exactly. And when the training is structured in that way, in which the processes are very clearly outlined with the system clicks and how you navigate the system, it also helps, you know, enhance people to actually want to use the system and get on board with it. Because when the processes are connected to the system clicks, it's easier for people to see how the new system hasn't just been implemented, you know, to make their life harder. It's actually been implemented to streamline the processes, to make their day-to-day activities easier, and actually to help them benefit in the long run. But when you do only show one aspect of training, which is just the system-based training, people don't get that bigger picture. They can't see how this is actually going to improve their day-to-day life. They just see, oh, another system. So that's why it's so important to mix the two together.
I see another. I'm sorry, go ahead, Jen.
No, I was going to say, and not just, oh, here's another system. It's, oh, here's another system and more work for me.
Exactly.
What's the benefit? And what you're talking about is conveying, no, This is how your role is changing. This is how you're achieving the same goal with a different process and a different tool, and it will be better for you in the long run.
And I think there's another piece that ties back to something we discussed a minute ago about alignment. And it's unfortunate, but I see this a lot in technology projects, that if people forget to talk about process, then they sort of assume everybody knows the process, everybody's mm-hmm. aligned on the process, that kind of thing. And then the system-based training just creates more problems because everybody's like, well, yeah, I saw you click this. But then they argue amongst themselves about what they're supposed to do when, because they've got different views of the process. Oh, I thought I was supposed to use this to do this to make that happen. Well, no, that's not how we work here. We do this. So, you know, if you misunderstand or disagree on the process and you're not aligned, sometimes it looks like the system's fault, right? I mean, it looks like the technology's problem. So it just, your point about training is it ties it all together. If what you're focused on is telling someone, look, I know yesterday you did this and this is how you did it, but tomorrow you're going to do this and this is how it'll work. If that's your answer to people, then you have to solve all those gaps and issues before you get there. I think that's a really great way of looking at how are you going to help the organization change.
Mm-hmm. Yes, for sure. And I think another really important point to mention here is training shouldn't be seen as a one-off activity that is done, you know, at the end of a project once the system has already been implemented. And training is just given, you know, okay, here's some training, two-day training, go and do that. Now let's start using the system. Training should be something that is actually done, you know, throughout a project, but also beyond a project. So, you know, once the system has been implemented, training should be a very regular occurrence because systems aren't stagnant. They have to develop, they have to change, even if it's small changes, or even if, you know, new users are being onboarded onto the system. Training should be regular to keep people, you know, informed and up to date, not only on the system itself, but also on the processes, as you were mentioning, Jonathan. So I think, yeah, one very key takeaway I would say is that training shouldn't be seen as a standalone part of a project. It should be seen as something that should be more of a sustainable activity that is carried all the way through and post-implementation.
There's another piece of that that I've seen you guys in particular be very good at and highlighting to people, which is, and I don't know if you'd call this training, but I feel like it's connected, and that is building a knowledge base that relates to the training, but goes deeper maybe than what the training course is, right? Because there's some people who are experts at things and they can write down exactly what you need to know about a certain topic, and maybe everybody doesn't need that every day, so it's not in the training, but
exactly.
When you get stuck, there's something to go to, right? And it's part of that continuum of, well, it is training. They're learning, but it's a different way of getting there, right?
Exactly. No, that's such a great point that that you raised, Jonathan, because like you said, people also learn in very different ways. Some people are more visual learners. Some people prefer to read more of, you know, a textbook manual type of document or format. And so because of this, another point is that it is very important when you are developing training materials during a digital transformation project, it's important that you actually do speak to the end users during this process to actually understand how they learn, because you could create the most incredible e-learning course or the most incredible video tutorial, but if that's not how people actually absorb knowledge and how they actually learn, then it's not going to be useful. So back to your point, Jonathan, about the knowledge base. Knowledge bases are great because you can have, you know, a centralized space for people to always go and refer to whenever they need support. And this sort of knowledge base should be something that is continually kept up to date with regular information, regular updates, regular content. And when we talk about regular updates, it doesn't have to be a whole course. It doesn't have to be a 20 video, you know, album. It can purely just be every now and then you upload a new cheat sheet, for example, which can just be a simple document that people can have on their desk next to them as they're working. Once they've done the training, they don't need to go through all the information again. They can just have a quick document to refer to when they're using the system. So I think it's also important to know that training doesn't have to always be these long, arduous sessions and processes. They can be like regular, like kind of golden nuggets of information that people can keep coming back to, but also being placed somewhere where they always know they're going to find great information and they don't have to search through thousands of documents to get one great piece of training information that's going to fit their needs.
And that comes back to your point about sort of continuous, right? It's not a one-time event. Oh, we're doing cutover training and now forget about training. It's, oh, I can be training myself, continuously improving how I use the system, learning more, offering even feedback, right? I imagine that that sort of, if that knowledge-based activity is a two-way communication, just like the communication early on, you get a lot more value out of that training and learning for other people too.
Exactly. Yeah, I'd say that's another very important point, that when you are, you know, providing training materials, it's always important. What we do at SharePLM is every 2 or 3 months, we do some sort of user interview or survey regarding the training materials. So essentially to see, well, yes, we will have spoken to the end users when we were first creating materials to see how they learn, what they want to learn. It's also important to keep going back to them, to making sure that the materials you are providing still fit their needs and still, you know, are still useful for them. And if they're not, then how can we develop those and improve that?
It makes sense.
So I'm going to head us down a different track. I'm kind of taking a look at our time, and I'm betting I'm going out on a limb and saying we're having Maria back, because there's no way we're getting through everything that we wanted to talk about today. But we've dug into some detail on what OCM is, how it goes beyond training, how important communication is. Let me throw like a kind of a ringer out there. Like, why is OCM even important? Like, I mean, the technology, right? This, I'm getting this new system. It's going to solve all my problems. Mm. Why is, I mean, digital transformation, right? PLM system. I'm going to get a PLM system. It's going to solve everything.
Yeah. At least that's what the software vendor said.
Exactly. So, you know, disabuse me of that notion.
Yeah, no, that's an interesting point. And I think, so to answer your question, the reason why OCM is so important, there's a statistic out there that I think we all have seen and are probably familiar with. It was a study conducted by McKinsey, which said that 70% of digital transformations fail, most often due to resistance from employees. So what is this telling us? This is telling us that we're having some amazing systems being implemented into organizations. The technical teams have done their job. They've made sure the business requirements are reflected in the system. They've ensured that all of the necessary systems are connected. But then what happens? 70% of these projects are failing because people just simply are refusing to use them, or they don't understand how to use them, or they simply just have some form of resistance that is stopping them from wanting to get on board with this. And so I think that answers the question, I think, very well. I think the people side of organizational changes is what should be the focus, as it is the main reason that many of these transformations fail. And for that reason, OCM, which, as we mentioned right at the beginning, is all about getting people on board with changes and making sure they have a smooth transition throughout this process. I think it sums up quite well why OCM is very important and should be highly prioritized within these types of projects.
Yeah, 70% failure rate's pretty damn high. And to your point, I'm guessing SharePLM wouldn't be around if OCM wasn't important.
Exactly.
I imagine that you guys have a similar experience to Razorleaf in terms of seeing those failures, right? You see those when a customer comes to you. Sometimes that's really a lot of opportunity for new business. We've certainly seen that plenty. Folks who come to us and say, well, you know, I got my PLM project started and I've got the software and we took a try at it, and maybe this is our second try, third try. You know, what would you guys do differently to help us out? Those are the questions we get. And of course, that cues you very quickly to, I see this didn't work the first time. Okay. I imagine you guys see a lot of that in your work?
Yes, definitely. I think something that we notice very often is a lot of projects that we start working on, we're not coming in right at the beginning, you know, for the system, you know, selection even. We're coming on in the beginning of a project almost to put out the fires that have started, because the systems have been implemented and people aren't using them. And now you have lots of executives who are very stressed and freaked out because they've just invested in this system and nobody is using it. And so I think something that this definitely shows us is that OCM isn't prioritized in a lot of these projects, and it's not seen as a crucial factor. And when it is seen as an important factor and the alarm bells start ringing, you then have to take a very reactive as opposed to proactive approach, which you would have been able to do if OCM was, you know, part of the strategy right from the beginning.
So you hit on a very important point that I really want to dig into, which is it is important. I know it's important. You know it's important. You know, we do this. We see this. But a lot of folks that we talk to, at least, they don't always understand that, right? There's a lot of conversation about, well, wait a minute, why do I need to do that? Hold on, I've got this PLM project, or not even PLM, this technology project or process change project. Why do I need OCM? I think I can just put the training in, like we've talked about. A lot of people see it that way, and just go with it, right? Everybody knows what we're doing. You hear these sorts of statements, right? So why? How do we talk to people like that? Do you guys see the same thing? How do you talk to people about that issue?
Definitely. It's actually a very common challenge that we face in a lot of our projects. And a lot of the time, the resistance does come in part from, you know, the senior management and the executives who are actually the ones who are meant to be backing the change, the ones who are in a dream world would be the champions for the change. And so a lot of the times you almost have to convince them that change management is important before you can even approach the, you know, the end users or other stakeholders. And so the way in which that we, you know, emphasize the importance of change management, well, firstly is through data, through case studies, through previous projects we've worked on where change management wasn't implemented, and then how things changed once it was, the increase in adoption rates, the reduction in resistance, the less risks, the better quality, et cetera. So I think definitely having data and case studies to back up your points is very important, but also to understand what the overall goals and objectives are of the people you're talking to, and then emphasizing the fact that in order to reach these goals, you know, lots of people need to be, like you've mentioned many times in this session today, Jonathan, need to be aligned, and making them aware that without this alignment, your vision and, you know, the project is never going to come to fruition. So it's kind of understanding what they want and then showing them how, in order to achieve that, there are lots of things you need to take into consideration that maybe haven't been taken into consideration up to now regarding OCM.
Well, and it sounds like respectfully and professionally challenging them, right? Mm. On maybe some assumptions that they've made or some preconceived notions that they have, to your point, with data, like with case studies, with examples, with, you know, look, I know you probably think that everybody knows the purpose of this project, but I'll tell you, you know, research shows that this percentage of managers don't fully understand the executive's vision for a project. You know, having those data points, right? And saying, I'm not saying you're wrong, but I'm saying, please reconsider this, because we see it a lot. Because we do, right? That's the issue, is it these things fail. And you, when you ask why, you get to the bottom of it and you see these things. You just need folks to understand that rather than, you know, sort of going along the path they go along every day, which is, you know, I think we're fine. We're running fine. Just to challenge them and say, no, this is a little different. This isn't day-to-day operations. It's a big project. It's a big change. Stop and think about, you know, is it going to work?
Definitely. I think in a lot of projects, kind of these ways of looking at OCM aren't always taken into account until, you know, consultants like us enter the projects and give kind of an outside perspective. Because I think a lot of the times when organizations can hear stories and, you know, maybe past failures and also past successes from similar companies that we may have worked with, they start actually to then think, okay, well, if this company is implementing change management and these have been the results and this is how you know, successful the adoption of the system has been since implementing OCM, then that's when the cogs start turning and they start to think, okay, well, this isn't the first rodeo sort of thing. Like, this has been done before and it has proven success. And this is, you know, the statistic when we don't implement OCM, you know, there's a 70% chance that this project won't be successful.
I want to take something you said and hopefully this is okay with time, Jen, because I think it's good to add in here. You mentioned earlier that a lot of times it's talking to executives to help them understand this, the value of this, the reason they need to do it, that sort of thing. I fully agree. And I will say that's not always successful, at least from our perspective. And what I like to leave people with, what I want to leave them with, and this is true for us, whether it's OCM or a technical part of the project, is what can you do, right? If you're not going to do the whole thing, or maybe not do it exactly the right way because you can't convince people. So that's what I would pose to you, Maria, is on the topic of OCM, what's your advice to people who need to do it themselves or can't convince management? Like, what should they try and add in that isn't just training?
Yeah, so that's a really great point. And there are definitely some quick wins that people can kind of look towards if they're not able to perform a full OCM strategy throughout their projects. And one of the ones I would say, and to bring us back to what we were discussing at the beginning, I would say one of the most essential components would be the narrative and the vision surrounding the change. Because this is something that is going to drive the rest of the transformation. And so if people get on board with the vision from the beginning, it's going to be a lot easier for them to not only get accustomed to the change, but also feel as if they've been involved from the beginning. Because I think a lot of the problems come when people feel that they've been an outsider for so long, and now they're trying to be thrown into the midst of new processes and new systems. So I would say if there's one thing that you do, it's make sure that you have a clearly defined vision surrounding the change and that this is well communicated to all of the key stakeholders.
That makes sense, right? So even if you're not an expert at this, you don't draft the most beautiful one, it's not entirely concise, you know, so maybe you don't do it exactly right, but the keys that you mentioned are do it, circulate it, get agreement on it, right? Because that's the key to the alignment piece. Exactly. And that's really what you're after.
Well, exactly. And I don't think that, I mean, I ideally, you know, we talked about the fact that you start that in the beginning before you start the transformation project itself. But I don't think that there's any point at which you can't create the narrative. So like if you went full on like and with your technology implementation, you did the training, and then you realize nobody's using it. Mm-hmm. I don't think there's any reason you can't then go back and say, okay, create the narrative then and kind of start weaving that all back in. This is why we're doing it and bring it all together at that point. It's not ideal. It's going to be a lot harder, but you can do it.
Exactly. Yeah, that's so important. I mean, a lot of the things we're saying is if we're living in, you know, our ideal environment, our ideal world, but a lot of the times, you know, we don't have the ability to be there at the beginning of projects, or OCM initiatives, for whatever reason, aren't included at the beginning of a project. And so just as you said, it doesn't matter where you are in the project, there's always time to align on the, or to regroup, realize things aren't working, realign on what the vision of the change is, and then make people aware of that and start the journey of getting people on board with not only the system, but also the reasoning behind it.
I think that comes back to something, you know, you mentioned earlier, and it's just all these things, it's about recognizing when it's a problem and then doing something about it instead of, well, it failed and I don't know why. And you only find out in a postmortem, you only find out in lessons learned later. That makes a lot of sense.
All right. Well, so keeping an eye on our time here, we wrap up a kind of the few major points that we made here and then have you guys can see if there's anything that I missed. Number one, high and about like the thing that really came out to me is the fact that not having or not considering organizational change management when you're doing a big digital transformation project is a leading cause of failure. Again, over 70% of projects fail because of this. That's a giant failure rate. And it's not, OCM is much more than training, because if it were just training, I feel like most companies actually do include training at some level of a new, for a new system. So if that was all it was, then we wouldn't be failing 70% of the time. So again, OCM is more than training. And if you don't know where to go, if you don't know where to begin, there are OCM professionals like SharePLM, like Razorleaf, et cetera, that can at least point you in the right direction. Yes, this is project work that we actually do, clearly SharePLM does, because that's, you know, the primary focus, but, you know, we can at least point you in the right direction. What are last points anybody wants to add on to that then?
I want to come back to the alignment piece, right? Maria brought this up, and it's a key piece of OCM, but I don't think we can understate it, right? It's, or we can't overstate it, excuse me. Like you mentioned, hey, if there's one piece of advice you'd give people, it's to pay attention to this one, right? Get that vision defined and align, because that can really address a lot of the things that crop up that cause the failures you mentioned, Jen. That's what I hear loud and clear out of this.
And Maria, anything you want to add as we wrap up?
I honestly, Jonathan said exactly what I would have said, but yeah, just to reiterate
that. That's terrible of me. I should have left that to you. I'm sorry.
No, not at all. But
you
yeah,
guys are well aligned.
We are well aligned. Exactly. So yeah, just ensuring that all stakeholders are aligned throughout a digital transformation, and you know, bringing that alignment into the vision in which people speak about the change, no matter which department they're in, no matter who their team is, making sure that everybody is, you know, as we say, singing off the same hymn sheet, can really help to ensure that a project is successful.
Well, I want to thank you, Jonathan, as always, for hosting and doing the introduction this time around.
Hey, every now and then, an old dog learns a new trick, every now and then.
And to you, Maria, and SharePLM for joining us today to share your expertise on how organizations can successfully adopt technology and process changes. I do feel like I feel at the end of so many podcasts that we have barely scraped the surface. And I wouldn't be surprised if we invite you back to say, okay, well, don't want to give away the farm, but like, what does creating a vision look like? What do you mean by role-based training? How mm-hmm. often should you communicate, and what does that look like? So don't be surprised if you get a call back from a Julianne saying, hey, you want to do another one?
Yeah, no, this has been really great, Maria. Thank you for doing this.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been great.
And I want to also, tell our listeners, if there are things here that you have questions about, reach out to us via social media, reach out to Jonathan or Maria, like additional questions. If there's anything we didn't cover that you'd like us to, that you'd like to see us cover in the next one, you know, again, give us that information. This is a conversation. It's a whole lot more interesting if you're in it. So, you know, we'd love to hear from you. And until next time, stay sharp.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you for being here and listening to this episode of Stay Sharp with Razorleaf. If you have any questions about this episode, we'd love to hear from you. Just leave us a comment on our post or send us an email at podcast@razorleaf.com. If you like this podcast, please be sure to hit the like button and subscribe to our podcast on your favorite podcast platform or on our YouTube channel. Until next time, stay sharp.